So turning now to Justice Gita Mittal, some say save the best for the last. And so Justice Mittal has worked tirelessly in promoting access to justice both in Delhi and now in Jammu and Kashmir, where she is as Chief Justice. And she has a number of wonderful stories which she has recounted to me and Shamnad. And they are diverse, as in from access to justice to the courtrooms in Delhi for ordinary litigants, to stories about vulnerable witness courtrooms. So I'm not going to limit her to any particular area, but leave her 10 minutes to say what she wants to about her experience of storytelling in the law.
A very good afternoon to all of you. Is it working?
Yeah.
You know, he says, leave a lot of storytelling, but says within 10 minutes. And for somebody who always has a lot to say, 10 minutes is very difficult. So I made sure I know where the clock is, and I'm sure he's going to interrupt me. But what I want to share with you, you know, is really my lessons in life, my lessons as a lawyer and my lessons as a judge. And it may come as a shock to all of you. I began studying law in 1978 purely by accident. I came to the bar in 1981. I practiced law for 23 years and I went to the bench in 2004. 14 years of judgeship, 23 years of law practice, 14 years, almost 15 years now of judgeship. I'm still learning. And my lessons have come not from heavy books. You know, no, I didn't go to Oxford, I didn't go to Cambridge, I only went to the Campus Law Center. But all my learning has come, most of my learning and all my learning has come from experiences and from people, you know, from individuals like each one of us in this courtroom. You know, many very erudite and learned as Justice B.N. Sri Krishna. Mr. Chandyok remains sir to me. Whenever I can call him, nothing else as sir. Yeah, I have seen him as, walked behind him as a lawyer, briefed him, opposed him, learnt pleading. There's an expression I use very lavishly in my judgment, utilizing the shield off. And I learned that when I got a written statement settled by Mr. Chandyok. Mr. Luthra, I haven't had professional engagement with, but I'm a tremendous admirer of the work that he has undertaken and the kind of initiatives that he's taking, especially in being so inclusive in his office and ensuring that he is including many of us who don't have the remotest chance of reaching out to law firms like his. And Shyam, I have no words to tell you. I'm still collecting all the judgments, all the cases which you're arguing and collating them, and hoping one day I'm going to have the space to read them from the first word to the end. You know, but certainly the principles which he is evolving, the arguments he is making, even if may not be accepted by the court, but are extremely relevant and pertinent to our consideration. You know, one of the learnings that I've had is in one of the trainings which I organized in Delhi. And this relates to training in the sexual violence area. And since 2009, I was working on this area after having had occasion to write a judgment in a case which is known as Virendra versus State. If you have followed the 2013 recommendations of Justice J.S. Verma, he has referred extensively to this judgment. But as part of a committee looking at the working of guidelines in sexual violence, I organized training for all the stakeholders, which included judges, prosecutors, lawyers, you know, legal aid lawyers, police personnel, doctors. And in this training, we had two sessions which we captioned as Voices from the Margins. One of these two sessions included representatives from the LGBT community. And for those of you who have engaged or worked in this area would have heard of Lakshmi Narayan Tripathi. She's an activist. She's a transgender from Mumbai who's very socially legally active in working on the rights. Now, Lakshmi, for those of you who have not seen her, is 6'3". She is spectacular. You know, she comes in red and gold, black and gold, hair up to the waist, all open, deep makeup, you know, dark red lipstick and a big bindi, etc. Now, you know, she stands in this room full of judges, prosecutors, lawyers, And you cannot imagine the her opening question. She begins with, am I invisible? Of course, there's going to be shocked silence in that room. You know, she repeats that question. Still nobody reacts. What a stupid question is the reaction. She repeats it a third time. And she asks the audience, why don't you reply? This time, there's a huge outcry of course not. We all see you. Her response is what stays with me. She retorts, and to this room full of educated, erudite, legally trained personnel, then why do you treat us so? You know, this sentence is so profound, you know, and it sets out that, you know, for my young friends, in case you're not able to understand what Lakshmi has said in this, is that why do you ignore us as a community? Why can't you see us? Where is the inclusivity in society? Where do you recognize our rights? And you know, this is a lesson, you know, in everything which all of us have said here, is something that we need to look at whenever we are looking at a legal problem from any perspective. Now let me share with you, Mr. Chandiok ended with an expression, access to justice, you know. Now, I will just tell you, I'll remind you, since there's very little time here, I had 5 very interesting stories, but I'll share only one because Shabnath said he thinks it's a very interesting story. I was elevated to the bench, I was appointed to the bench in 2004. We used this expression, elevated. But I went to the bench in 2004, to my shock. First generation lawyer, I've had to struggle, you know, through the hierarchies. But I was completely shocked and in awe of the position where I was suddenly in. And this was about 2006 or 7. That means I was only a judge of 2 years, 3 years vintage, when I was sitting in the writ jurisdiction of the Delhi High Court. And I got this case where of a writ petition, I had seen it, glanced over it the night before, which had been filed by a person who was saying that he had a shanty in the Jama Masjid area, for the Turkman Gate area, which was demolished in the emergency demolitions. 1975, his old shanty was demolished. His right to rehabilitation was recognized by the Municipal Corporation of Delhi, which in 1976 or 70, immediately after the emergency, the government started making reparative actions, trying to restore some confidence in the citizens of Delhi who had suffered excesses. And he was offered a plot, a small plot or a flat which had been built by the government for people whose properties had been demolished during the emergency. This man said, despite the slip which he filed with the writ petition having been issued in 1976, the MCD had failed to give him the property till 2006, and he sought a direction to the MCD, Municipal Corporation, to hand over possession of that flat. Now you can very well imagine what would be the response of the Municipal Corporation. They so vehemently were contesting and saying that this relief is barred by what is the doctrine which governs, you know, writ jurisdiction. It is not, there's no limitation, but delay and latches. That his claim and entitlement to relief was barred in law, and I should dismiss the writ petition. You know, next to that lawyer who wasn't very articulate, he wasn't the most competent of legal lawyers, we used to be a man standing next to him, and a man in a white kurta pajama, long white beard up to his waist, and standing there always with folded hand. Most litigants are extremely diminutive in the courtroom, you know, and I constantly have to tell them that you don't have to fold your hands, you're asserting a right, you're making a legal claim. So this man was standing. So I started asking him a couple of questions. So I asked him, Baba, umar kitni hai? What is your age? The man said, 86. So I said, ye aapka ghar to toda tha 1976 mein, 1976 mein, aap kahan the? So he says, mera ghar tod diya, usi ghar mein mera furniture repair shop tha. So, and maine kaha, kitna bada ghar tha? To 5 feet by 7 was the size of the room which he occupied for residential purposes as well as for his shop. So I said, aapka parivar kitna bada hai? So he said, main hu, meri patniya, biwi hai, aur humare 6 bachche hai. He was a Muslim gentleman. So I said, what happened to you after this demolition? He says, उसके बाद तो जी हमको रोटी बनाने का जगह ढूंढना था, कोई पेड़ ढूंढना था जिसकी छाया में हम बैठ सकते, और एक दिन हम किसी पेड़ के नीचे पड़े थे, एक दिन एक्सीडेंट हुआ तो हमारा हिप बोन टूट गया, फ्रैक्चर हो गया, कई साल होली फैमिली हॉस्पिटल में पड़े रहे. सो देयर आई आस्क्ड हिम, आई सेड, वर यू एबल टू एजुकेट दिस फैमिली? सो ही लॉस्ट हिज लाइवलीहुड, ही लॉस्ट हिज हाउस, हिज फैमिली इज ऑन द स्ट्रीट, द सिक्स चिल्ड्रन. आई सेड, ही सेड, सवाल ही नहीं उठता, पैसे कहाँ थे, रोटी खाने के पैसे नहीं थे. So as a result of this demolition, we have created so much dependency on the community and society. We have created 6 uneducated children and a family with so much difficulty. Then at the all this time, this MCD lawyer is harping, you know, crying horse, limitation, delay, latches, no right. So then I asked him, I said, did you recognize his entitlement to rehabilitation? You issued the slip. He said, yes, we did it. But now the flat must have gone. And in this order, to cut a long story short, I think I've cut out my time is over. What I had to say was that his entitlement to his house was his right to shelter. It has been recognized as an essential concomitant of the right to life under Article 21 of the Constitution of India. And constitutional rights are not defeated by delay and latches. The government had recognized this right, and I issued time-bound directions to the corporation to hand over the property to this man. I tried to tell the municipal corporation lawyer that this man would not be thinking of chasing that slip of paper. His first priority would be in trying to find food for his family, then finding some kind of a shelter. But what this case, and also wrote in this case, this was, you'll understand why delay and latches. You know, Turkman Gate is barely 1.5, it can't be beyond 3 kilometers from the Delhi High Court. 1976 was the demolition. 2006, this man had garnered the courage to come to court. 30 years to walk 3 kilometers. So, and we are talking of Delhi, where legal aid is very strong, the court is very vocal on the entitlements of people. But this case threw up it is such a stark reality on the kind of barriers which accessing justice can have, you know. It is not simply related to legal aid being there and available. It is relatable to illiteracy, it is relatable to ignorance of legal procedures, insecurity about legal procedures, you know, fear of ostracization, fear of the process itself, you know. So I issued time-bound directions, recognizing all these barriers and these handicaps that this man had, and hoped fervently. It's seldom that you want to follow a case. Justice Krishna will bear me out that if you start thinking of what happens to your judgment, you'll never move ahead. You'll always be apprehensive. So you try to put cases out of the way. But somehow the reality and the difficulties of this man stayed with me. And I always wondered and hoped, you know, prayed that he'd got the flat. Till recently, my law researcher, I summoned the courage to ask him, check what happened to that judgment. And I found out that the corporation appealed. And the division bench, in a 3-para judgment, set aside my order, holding only citing a Supreme Court judgment on delay and latches, nothing else, you know. I had propounded, waxed eloquent on access to justice. But my learnings, you know, have been tremendous from this little experience. I understood all about access to justice, and I also, you know, most starkly, and now I say it in a series of judgments, that access to justice is not restricted, is not synonymous with access to courts. It is way beyond and much more. So I think I've overstepped my 10 minutes, and I'll have to stop. Someday there are many, many more stories.